I'm very happy now. I mean, I work in a museum for glass. For me, it was kind of like holding candy in front of me, and I was just excited to be there.
Are you feeling at home right now?
Yeah.
Wow.
So what's he doing now?
Now he's picking it up with his hands, and he's going to put it in an oven. Wow. So the whole time he's working glass, he can never let it get below 900 degrees or it'll shatter.
Wow. Have you ever had one crack or shatter?
Sure.
Whoa. I hope my flower doesn't crack.
I mean, you have to. To become a glassblower, you got to love it, because the first 2 years, everything cracks.
How do you get the different colors? Is it just dye or?
No, the different colors are made with different minerals. I wish I could have got down onto the floor and played with some hot glass, but just to be near it and to be able to explain it to some new friends that I have was just an amazing feeling. I've been a glassblower for 38 years. I was in the Army during the end of the Vietnam era. I got out of the service and went into college. And so I took glassblowing just to kind of unwind from this crazy things that I had seen while I was in the Army. And as soon as I saw glass, I was in love. It was this hot, molten, sexy material. And I'm still just madly in love with the material. I have an amazing son that is a glassblower also. He's becoming a phenomenal glassblower. He's progressed in glass quicker than anyone I have ever seen.
Yeah.
In my son, I mean, I can see the connection between me and him, the similar feelings, the similar aesthetics, how not only negative tendencies can be passed down, but maybe a realization of those, and yet other things can be passed down. It is hard to believe, isn't it?
Yeah.
I mean, who would have thought that I would be going to Sweden? I never thought I'd be going to Sweden. But I mean, I am doing this for you and for myself and for my brother, too, and for Liam. Just, I think it would be amazing if we could find some Swedish roots, because now that Carl died, you know, we really have no connection.
No, and
at all. Both my grandfather and my father killed themselves. My sister also died. Maybe it was a suicide. So it's just my brother and I that are left on the Swedish side.
Yeah. Well, it's going to be a pretty cool story to add to your already amazing list of cool stories that you have.
That's true. I'm 60. I'm getting older. I have faced my mortality. I was diagnosed with cancer, and this is a chance to pass something down to my son while I'm still here. And this just seems like a beautiful thing to connect with him with. The only thing that I know about my Swedish ancestry is my grandfather and grandmother coming from Sweden. I know nothing of any other relatives in Sweden. That's a hole in my life. I want to have that very much. Now that I know I'm right on the verge of finding some answers, I'm in a field full of buttercups with horses around me, woods around me. I mean, I feel it. Ah, just the smell of the air. I feel at home.
Dear Kurt, your story begins with Johannes Andersen, born in 1838 in Sigerstad, Värmland. These were desperate times. Death threatened everyone, and most days were all about survival. His father was a roving cobbler who sought shoe repair work at local farms.
When he suddenly died, Johannes and his mother were left to face an ominous future alone. I can relate to that. I remember having to clean my
father's apartment after he died, going through all his possessions.
But Johannes was clever and determined to seize the opportunity. When 19, he left home for work as a farmhand.
In 1868, he married Maria Lartsdatter, and their son Herman was born 2 years later, destined to leave his indelible mark on my family's history.
This is my great-grandfather. Hey! Wow. Yeah, it's a good-looking guy.
When 24, Herman was an honorably discharged veteran with a new job as a farmhand.
Just like me, an honorably discharged veteran.
He met and fell in love with a woman named Anna Andersdatter. She and Herman wed in 1900, and her turn-of-the-century ring remains in your family.
This is the ring. This is the one I kept. Herman and Anna, 1900. Touching and feeling and almost wearing the wedding ring of my great-grandparents. I hope they can feel me too.
Together they produced 4 children, Carl, Arvid, Hildur, and Valdemar. Herman had his mind set on something more than mere survival. He first parlayed farmhand work to a lower leadership role on a farm in Sigerstad. 5 years later, Herman became a landowner, buying a small farm in Grooms, Spitjulmossen. Finally, Herman could provide his family with a proper home of their own.
I love that gate. I'm actually going to copy that when I get home. This all looks so familiar. It feels familiar. It's like I've been here. I wonder if my grandfather's with me now.
Walking up to my grandfather's house was amazing. Just to smell the air and look around and hear the birds, to know that that my family grew up there.
Wonder what he'd say and what stories he'd tell me. He's probably got a story for every part of this place.
Herman and Anna were considered extraordinarily kind and good citizens here in Grooms. History shows that their generosity even changed lives. When the priest ended up with a newborn girl in need of a foster home, they couldn't say no. That girl, Anna Lisa, became a permanent part of the family.
It's my great-grandfather. Oh, damn. Herman Johansson, I'm your great-grandson. Come to visit you. Coming back to Sweden, coming back to my roots. You had an amazing son, Herman. And I enjoyed my time with him. I loved him dearly.
Their oldest son, Carl, your grandfather, did farm and factory work.
Another picture of my grandfather. Looking kind of dapper here.
But he also wanted something more. In 1923, he bought a one-way ticket to America, boarded MS Kuxholm in Gothenburg, and immigrated with $25 in his pocket.
Wow.
Spitjulmossen, the name of this farm in Grooms, is also the place where Carl lived before leaving for America. His brother Arvid and Valdemar later took over the farm.
That's it. Wow. I wonder what would bring someone to leave this place. Carl loved his new country.
Fate led him to Clara Sundström, whom he married in 1925. His contact with family in Sweden faded over time, basically stopping with his mother Anna's death in 1951. In 1982, a few years after tragically losing his son, Carl took his own life. He was 81. His sister, Hildur, kept the letter she received from Carl.
It's amazing.
Yes, it's 46 years since I left. I will always remember that day in April. You were so young and beautiful. I remember you being in the kitchen at Svjutsenmosen with a little girl. You cried when I left. A minute I will never forget.
So he was obviously very homesick. And I can see why. It's a beautiful place that he left.
And now I'm here. I'm standing, I'm in the space that he was in. I hope he can feel me.
This is an amazing gift to be able to complete this circle like this.
It's difficult to put into words. I feel a strange calmness knowing my history, my roots. And that's forever. Relationships may come and go, but the bloodline is forever.
Hello? Caleb?
Dad!
Hey! How you doing? Happy birthday.
Good. It's good to hear your voice.
Yeah, it's great to hear your voice. Guess where I'm at?
Somewhere in Sweden.
Yep, I'm somewhere in Sweden. I'm sitting on grandfather's porch that he grew up at, this farm. So I,
really?
Yeah. And then I found out when Carl left, I found some letters that he had sent back and that he was kind of getting homesick. Anyway, I wish you were here.
Yeah, I wish I was there too. It sounds amazing.
It is.
Maybe one day we'll go back.
I hope so. In my mind, this is all for you.
Yeah.
So,
I love
you too, Caleb. So you take care. Tell everybody I love them. Having a great time and finding our history. And it's going to be our history. Bye-bye. I'm here, Grandpa. I'm here. God, I love you.